Hello and welcome to this edition of Prophecy in the News Update. I'm Kevin Clarkson, your host, and I want to bring you some current information that's going on in our nation. America was shocked last week when the city of Houston issued legal subpoenas to pastors demanding sermons, emails, and other correspondence relative to certain topics addressing an ordinance in the city. Now, when we peel the lid off of this, first of all, we're shocked that pastors would even have their sermons subpoenaed. Most pastors I know would be glad to have anyone come and hear their sermons. They're certainly not trying to hide anything. But to use the fist and force of law to try to obtain that for possible prosecution is another matter entirely. What was going on, if you haven't heard, in the city of Houston was the city council had passed an ordinance under the leadership of their mayor, Anise Parker, this last year. And that ordinance basically would make all restrooms in the city buildings gender-free so that anybody could use any restroom, saying that they might be male or female, depending on how they might have felt that day. And obviously, this is open to abuse and misuse, as well as just creating, I believe, a lot of unnecessary confusion. The sad thing is, when the city council passed that, the citizens of Houston reacted. They weren't happy about it, and they were actually following the procedures of their city government. They got a petition together, and they got over three times the necessary signatures. I believe they needed 17,000 signatures, and they obtained over 50,000. And so they came with three times the amount, and the council began to look at that, and they began suddenly to work to disqualify those signatures. Without any other recourse at this point, the city is a little flummoxed about what to do. And when we begin to dig even deeper, we realize that the mayor, Anise Parker, is lesbian and seems to have an agenda. When I first heard this story, my reaction was, well, that didn't take long. We've been assured by the teachers of tolerance that there's no agenda here with gay rights other than protecting the oppressed. But we've always sensed from what we've seen overseas in Europe and in Canada that there might be a coming after criminalizing the pure teaching of Scripture. And I just want to relate this to two biblical principles. One has to do with the actual, you know, coming of the Lord and prophecy. I believe it's a sign of the times. We often say the words of Jesus that as it was in the days of Noah, so it will be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. And that's correct, and we've emphasized that. And when he mentions Noah, I'm looking in Luke 17. He says, they did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. Well, you read that and that sounds like a lot of normal activities, eating, drinking, giving in marriage, etc. But if you go on in Luke's gospel, Luke says that Christ also added this statement, Luke 17, verse 28, likewise also as it was in the days of Lot. They did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they builded. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. And even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. I would just say and observe with you quickly that, you know, as you compare those two instances of Noah and Lot, there is a difference. The days of Lot don't mention marrying and giving in marriage. Something that is universal, something that is in every culture of the world, and yet in the city of Sodom and Gomorrah, it doesn't mention that they were marrying and giving in marriage. It's my contention and belief that when we, if we just expand marriage to mean everything, that in the end it actually means nothing. And that's exactly what we've seen in Northern Europe that legalized gay marriage over a decade ago. And over time, marriage has been less embraced by a new generation. Many people are living together, they're siring children, and then they're not staying together and fragmenting. And basically the family as a unit, as God designed it, is just really dissolving, and it's leaving all kinds of unusual arrangements for trying to rear children. Of course, that's what some want. They want the state to raise children, and they want to abolish the family. That was the dream of Karl Marx, who wanted to obtain children when they were 6 months old. But we're seeing that this is just a sign of the time. And I thought America might hold out a bit longer, but as we look at what's happened in these last few years, when we actually look at the numbers, 31 states passed legislation that defined marriage as what is natural between a man and a woman, male and female, created he them, the Scripture says. And 31 states with a total vote collective of 42 million people in those states said that's the definition of marriage. They prevailed in all 31 states. Nowhere where the people have voted has it actually been otherwise, except for one instance. Now, against the 42 million that said that, most of those states have had that overturned by judges. And the total number of judges ruling is 23. Not 23 million, 23. So we have 23 individuals and 42 million individuals, and the 23 have prevailed in our land. And a sign of the times. And I believe that God's people need to continue their witness. The other thing I would point out in this is, sad to say, really sad to say, the largest church in America is in Houston, Texas. It's Lakewood Church. It's pastored by Joel Osteen. And I learned this week that he was actually invited and prayed at Mayor Anise Parker's inauguration when she was first brought into office. And at that inauguration ceremony, his prayer included the phrase that she was raised up for such a time as this. I find that incompatible with what the Scripture says. She was not raised up for this type of action. And the sad thing is, if that church had simply mobilized with their attendance and membership, they would have had enough signatures in that one church to have come and been able to meet the requirements that the city demands in its outworkings. Now let me just say this. A lot of Christians back off any kind of involvement in the political process, and they say we're to submit to the authorities. We are to submit to the authorities. That's what the Bible says. But the Bible also makes very clear that the authorities and the government structures are different in different times and places. And you and I are privileged to live in a land that is actually governed by the consent of the people. And it's we, the people, who are that authority. And so we would be wise to look in the Bible and see when people exercised their rights. And I'll go to a famous passage in Acts 16. Paul's been in prison. This was the original jailhouse rock. He and Silas were put in prison overnight. They'd been beaten, and they began singing praises to God at midnight, and an earthquake came. And when the earthquake happened, the doors of the cell flew open, the chains dropped off of their wrists, and the jailer took up his own sword to end his life, because under penalty of Roman law, he thought of the inmates escaped, he would have to die anyway. Paul cried out, "Do yourself no harm." And the man fell on his knees trembling and said, "What must I do to be saved?" And Paul said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy household." And that man was saved, and the evidence was in what happened next. He took Paul and Silas to his house, washed their wounds that he had inflicted, fed them a meal, and his entire family heard the gospel and was baptized that night. Now, Paul goes back to prison because he's being submissive to what has happened at this point. Verse 35 of Acts 16 says, "When it was day, the magistrates sent unto the sergeants, saying, Let those men go. And the keeper of the prison told this saying to Paul, The magistrates have sent to let you go. Now therefore depart and go in peace. So the jailer is saying, It's okay. I guess they thought it was a one-night sentence. You're free to go. But watch what happens in verse 37. Paul said unto them, They have beaten us openly, uncondemned, that is, without a trial, being Romans, and have cast us into prison, and now do they thrust us out privily? Nay, verily, let them come themselves and fetch us out." Paul knew that the law had been violated, and he claimed his rights as a Roman citizen. And the next verse says, "The sergeants told these words unto the magistrates, and they feared when they heard that these men were Romans. And they came and besought them, and brought them out, and desired them to depart out of the city." Now let me tell you why Paul did that. He wasn't insistent on demanding his own rights. He was stoned in another city. He would have given his life for Christ. It wasn't about putting anyone in their place. But he knew that he had a brand new infant church that had just been planted with brand new baby Christians. And he knew that for their sake and for the sake of what was right, he would take a stand so that they could be preserved. And I want to appeal to the people of God in the United States. We live in such a great nation. We've had such religious freedom and liberty. It's been the hallmark and the fountain of all of our other liberties. If we don't stand in this hour and address what are our basic rights and bring our grievance to have this fixed, we will lose the liberty that we've taken for granted all of our lives. Most of the world has never had this kind of religious freedom. And I promise if we let it slip, we will not gain it back in a day or a month or a year. or perhaps a generation. Let's be warned. Let's fight the good fight till He comes and keep looking up. Thank you.